Matchmaker Communications 101 presents the 40th Street Group. Kathy Droz and Bob Fishman bring together an amazing mix of business and community world changers, making a difference in Arizona and around the world. And now, let's join Kathy and Bob and the 40th Street Group. Welcome back for another, in fact, our a Happy New Year episode of the 40th Street Group. You know why, Alan, you realize that I went through the whole show last time, and I forgot to wish you and our guests and our audience Merry Christmas, and it's been bothering me ever since.
And I know, and now it's Happy New Year.
It is Happy New Year. That one I'm not forgetting. I hope you had a great New Year celebration.
Oh, it's fabulous. I mean, you wouldn't believe.
I can't wait to hear the details.
Yes.
But we have shows today. By the way, I want to catch up on something. We had a great show 2 weeks ago with most of our guests are back in the studio today, but we had Ed Phillips, we had Richard Holland and Bill Mann 2 weeks ago, and we've got Richard and Bill back in the studio with us, along with Renee. Gero is our replacement for Ed. Nobody can replace Ed, but I think Renee can do a really heck of a... Just like you can't replace Kathy Droz, but you're a heck of a substitute, you know?
Heck of a substitute. I'm certified substitute.
You are certified in some things, I'm sure. But back to that. You're a certified pilot, right?
I am.
You're a certified real estate guy, right?
I am.
And you're like a certified musician?
I am.
All right. This is great stuff to reestablish. So we had a great conversation...
That was terrific.
That was sort of internet related, and you didn't get to comment. So give us about a 60-minute thing of how you were thinking about real estate related to what that conversation. And basically, what we were talking about was the effect of the internet on business and media and stuff like that. But you had a comment as far as real estate.
I did. I was going to say is that I got started in the internet with real estate in 1994. And I started marketing my homes online, and I put the www.alanripa.com sign on my real estate sign. So I would get calls on the homes, and then they would ask, what is all that www stuff? And I said, well, it's the internet. And they say, what are you doing with that? And I said, well, I've got my listing on there because I built a website that had all the information of the property. And I said, you can go online and see it. Well, most of the people didn't have a connection to the internet. And then I would tell them about AOL, and you can get a disk where they give you 10 hours free. So if you would just try the internet. And so, because that's how I got my start was.
So you were pretty early on in this stuff then.
Yes.
And did it translate to real estate business for you on the internet very quickly or at all, or did
it took a long time because it was the market was growing into it. Mm-hmm. But
you were ahead of the game, basically.
I saw that it could be a useful tool, and so that's where I got into where now I do these high-end productions. And I was mentioning earlier what it does allow me to do is to package like a multi-million dollar home, and within a couple hours, I can be advertising it in Dubai, in China, in Germany, Italy, anywhere in the world within a couple hours. And it's just amazing on how fast you can now get product to the world, actually.
But once the United States closes borders to everybody, that won't be of any use to you anymore. I love that look you're giving me.
Okay,
I'm talking about some recent political history. I'm just joking, sort of.
I know.
So at that point, when we close our borders to everybody, that all that internet reach will only work for you domestically, I guess. So
yes, I'll good be luck. Just limited you know, at that domestically. Point. Yes.
Let's get to our guests in the studio.
It's gonna be a rough show today, right? Here
I
we go.
I can't resist every once in a while. I just can't resist. But we've got, like I said before, we've got Richard Holland back with us, Bill Mann, and we've got Renee.
We've got
Gero,
our new guest.
Let's find out a little bit about Renee, who she is, and what she does, and let's see if she can get to that microphone just like that. And Renee, tell us a little bit about yourself, okay?
Well, basically 25 years I was in the aerospace business.
Doing what?
I used to sell turbine components that went in aircraft engines as well as industrial gas turbines power plants.
How did you get in that business? As a female, and this is some 10, 15 years ago?
Well, yeah, sort of.
A few years ago, right?
A few years ago.
Okay, so how did you break through into that industry?
It was very difficult, to say the least, because back then, basically, women were only allowed to be teachers, secretaries.
Nurses,
and the like.
So how did you, what did you have an in? How did you make that breakthrough?
It was very difficult. I got in there from the accounting background that I have. They had an opening within the accounting department, and I took that job. And then lo and behold, all of a sudden they had a opening within the sales department, wanted someone coming in to do estimating and put together an estimating system. So basically they hired me to do that as well as become a salesperson.
And was that a commission-based position or salary-based?
No, it was a salary base at that time. And then I did that for a number of years. My sales manager asked me at the time, he says, so what are your goals? And I told him within 5 years I was going to be a field rep selling out in the field directly to the customers. And I was told I was very bullish, and I said, well, you asked me a question, and I gave you an answer.
And did you do that within the 5 years?
Oh, yes. The day of my five-year anniversary, he gave me my anniversary pin that morning, then called me back in the afternoon and said, the vice president of sales and marketing wants you up in Connecticut for an interview. I said, oh, you already gave me my pin, so what's this all about? He says, well, you did want to get out in the field within 5 year span. And I said, well, yeah. He says, well, is this in time enough? And I said, I think so.
And what company was this for?
This at the time was Helmet Corporation.
Helmet?
Yes.
And they
sell to all the engine manufacturers, GE, Rolls-Royce,
et
cetera.
Where were you based out of?
At the time, I was based out of New England.
And so you had a territory, I assume?
Yes, I did. Uh-huh.
How big was that territory, New England or what?
Well, basically New England. However, GE's all over the world, so I was traveling all over
the
world.
So you became a part of GE then or what?
They were my main customer at that time.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And so what was the next step? After you did that, then what?
Well, I then got promoted throughout the company, but then I took another job as a promotion with their competition.
Oh, okay.
So I was then sales manager of a $60 million plant at the time.
Wow.
And brought their sales up drastically because they needed a larger customer base. And basically I worked on that.
So how many years total were you in the sales industry?
25 years.
And then what got you out of it?
Well, the recession came and a president decided that we were going to have a lot of the work done basically out of the border, out of the country, in foreign countries. And so
that took a lot of your
customer
base away, I suppose.
Right, it did. And a lot of us within the states lost our jobs.
And were you still in New England at the time? Or?
No, I was in Arizona.
So what brought you to Arizona?
Job transfer.
Okay.
I was still in aerospace at the time.
And so you're talking about the 2008 recession? Which recession are you talking
about? No, this was around 2000.
Okay. So when that happened, how did you land? Where did you land next?
I got into real estate.
Okay.
And been doing that for 15 years.
All right. And then, but right now, what are you doing currently? Let's bring you up to date right now. What's your current thing?
Okay. Well, last year I was hired after a 12 year of being a Vincentian, which is a volunteer for St. Vincent de Paul.
Okay.
I was hired to head up a program that was new to Phoenix called Systemic Change.
And so you're heading up that program?
I'm doing that, and I'm also in charge of one of their major departments.
And after we get back from our commercial break, we'll probably find out more detail about that, and we will get to other guests because we've got two other fabulous guests in the studio with us. But we always, when we have a new guest on a show, we always emphasize them in the first segment. And so since Renee is new to the show, we wanted to get to hers. So we've got Renee Gero with us, Richard Holland and Bill Mann. And I forgot that we have the ghost of Ed Phillips
here.
Yeah,
yes.
He's still here, kind of. I'm Bob Fishman along with Alan Ripa, the 40th Street Group. We'll join you right back here in about 2 minutes after these commercial breaks.
welcome back to KFNX 1100 AM, and I'm here with Bob Fishman as my co-host.
Happy New Year again, Alan.
Happy New Year. I'm Alan Ripa, and I'm in the studio here with Richard Holland, Bill Mann, and Renee Gero. And we're going to get back with Renee on where she's at a little more in depth with St. Vincent de Paul, the organization that she is.
Yeah, what did you call systemic? What was it called?
Systemic change is what she's
doing. Is that what it was?
But tell
yes,
us more.
Correct. Systemic change is the direction that we are going in from a standpoint. It was something that our founder back in 1834 actually did. And basically, it's thinking outside the food box. We do many things from a standpoint of helping someone go beyond what their situation is currently, which is causing them the difficulty that they're in crisis mode for the time being. And potentially, they may need to get a GED, further their education, get a certification so they can get a better paying job. Unfortunately, the recession of late was a big hit for a lot of families, and it crossed all barriers. People were losing their jobs left and right, or their hours were cut back. And basically, some of them didn't even know what to do or what the resources were because they were never in that predicament before.
So you are, I guess another way of putting it might be, and I'm very big on the concept of you're not just handing out fish, you're trying to teach people how to fish for a lifetime, basically.
Exactly.
And so this kind of relates in a way to Richard Holland in terms of the fact of he's had some really interesting. Richard seems to be knowledgeable about many, many things, including turbine engines and everything else. It's amazing. But Richard, why don't you, since this is a new show and some people might not have been listening 2 weeks ago, catch us up briefly on sort of the span of your career path and interest path, and then we're going to go a little bit more in depth with both you and Bill in terms of some of the part of that journey. So,
okay. Well, I spent the first two-thirds of my career, going back literally when Nixon was president until the early 2000s, in broadcasting.
What kind of broadcasting?
Primarily television, but we also had radio and print.
And what was your role in that?
Initially was on the journalistic side, and then it evolved into the marketing side, and marketing in terms of creating the image for the newscast and the image of the news anchors and building viewership and increasing our viewership.
And when you say starting on the journalistic side, that means you were a reporter? What does that mean?
Okay. When I was in eighth grade, I used to develop the news film for the 6 o'clock news after school. So
that's
they trusted
beautiful.
A 13-year-old to run the film processor for the 6 o'clock news. And from there, as long as I was developing the film, I learned how to go out and shoot film. And if I shot film, I might as well take some notes of what I was seeing. And if I was going to take those notes, I might as well write it. And if I was going to write it, I might as well create it. So it was all completely self-taught. So by the time I was in high school, I was the producer
of the
10 o'clock news.
The 10 o'clock
news
for where?
A small town in South Louisiana down on the bayou.
It doesn't matter how small it was. You were producing the 10 o'clock news. Is
well,
that right?
As a year old? I was in high school.
Okay.
But it was sort of like WKRP in Cincinnati.
It
was just a wacky place where I could get away with making all kinds of mistakes.
This is where you started breaking the rules, basically.
Yeah.
You are a rule breaker, you told us.
But the most profound part was it was all self-taught. It was try something. If it works, do more of it. If it doesn't work, well, don't
How
do that anymore.
How did you get people to take you seriously at that
By
point?
By just doing it.
But to get that first opportunity to get them to take you seriously.
Well, I work for free.
Okay.
I would ride my bike over there and hang out because it was just a cool place to hang out in the TV newsroom.
And the
reason I became the film processor, it was a 2-hour long drudge job that nobody wanted to do. So the guy who was doing it, I started doing favors for him, doing it more and more and more. So after I did that for about a year, and a summer was coming up after between 8th and 9th grade, the news director pulled me aside and said, you're here all the time anyway. How'd you like to get paid for it? So we could depend on you. And minimum wage was $1.65 an hour, which I went, oh, wow, I can get new tires for my bicycle.
What was it like when you went home and told your parents?
Okay, here was the, no, it wasn't so much that, but the first time I ever got to make a decision, a choice of something that showed up on the air, it was, we had this, so the news anchors would have a graphic over their shoulder that related to what the story was. And back then, everything was either on film or on slides. And we had a rack of thousands of slides of every sort of possible subject matter. And when it came to murder, there was the knife, there was the gun, there was the long gun, the short gun, the fingerprint, the detective's magnifying glass, all these different genres. So I would read through the script, see what kind of a murder it was, pick the slide, put that in the order, then run home on my bike. And when that story came up, I could tell my parents, I chose that. I did that. I made that
happen.
Did they
believe you? Did they believe
you?
Yeah. Yeah.
They were like,
but when you came home with a paycheck, were they like stunned?
No, because I had a paper route before that, okay. So I was already making money. And
but
with
making
that money
from a TV station, though.
I think it was less than what I was making on my paper route,
but
though.
Still, it was a TV station.
But it was
station.
Still enough to okay. buy flying lessons when I was 12 years
oh,
old.
Oh, wow. That's and you were a pilot, right?
I am a pilot. That's how I met
all right, so,
Mr. Ripa.
So let's speed up, because that's a great yes. start. So let's speed up. So as you became serious into your adult career, your path really went to some pretty big stuff in the media field before you started transitioning. So tell us a little bit about some of the heights that you reached.
I have a bunch of Emmys on my shelf. I have forgotten the exact count, but I've
done. Do you know what they were for, at least?
Well, they were mainly for promotion, what are called promotional announcements. The commercials about why someone should watch the news or watch a particular station.
And where are these Emmys from?
They were from the Rocky Mountain NATS, National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences.
Yeah, Ellen, didn't you get an Emmy like from that organization
as well?
I did,
in 2009.
Yeah. Okay, so right. I had a feeling.
So we got two Emmy winners.
Wow, that's so okay. So a bunch of Emmys, but tell us again. I'm sort of leading up to something okay. that you. I know a tiny bit about your background. So gradually, eventually, you start taking your skill sets to what levels?
Well. Through the television company that I worked with, we did business with the studios that create a lot of television shows. Mm-hmm. And the television shows, and I'll throw out some names, Oprah, Wheel of Fortune, Jeopardy, Entertainment Tonight, Dr. Phil, just for some, will invite folks from the local television stations to come and visit with them and spend time with them to give them a sense of what their audience likes. And or will react to or will play in their market, because obviously a New England is different from a Des Moines, is different from a Chicago or Los Angeles or Houston or Phoenix. So I had the opportunity to meet and spend time with a number of really high profile, not only the television personalities, but the executive producers behind those programs. And then would end up being in a position to actually be able to influence the direction of the program and then
so
new programs.
Early on in their development, for example?
Over the course of, the mid-80s to the early 2000s.
So like when you're working with the Oprah Winfrey people, this is pretty early in her?
I met Oprah very early in her career, and then we stayed in touch through about until I left television.
And same thing with Dr. Phil?
Dr. Phil, I met before there was a Dr. Phil show,
okay.
And then I was invited to have input into how the show shaped up in the year leading up to before it was a show.
All right, so this is we sort of established a little bit of the depth and strength of Richard. Bill, we only have a short time before our commercial break. Give us a real quick, and we'll get more of this in the next segment. Give us a little bit of background in terms of how. We love the story in the last show about your book, Paula Goes to the Pound. Is that what it's called?
Yes, it is.
And so you're an author. You're specialized in children's books?
No, I just happen to write a children's book. I'm an eclectic author. I've written a book on poker. I've written a novel, this children's book, and half a dozen screenplays. And I got to say, Richard Holland, if somebody throws a dark hood over your head, it's me kidnapping
well,
you.
Well, here's what's going
to
happen.
To a secret location.
Our next segment, we're going to get into more of that. We are the 40th Street Group. I'm Bob Fishman along with Alan Ripa. And we're discovering new things about Bill Mann as we sit here. So join us back after the next commercial break. And we're going to hear about this kidnapping about ready to take place in the studio.
Thank you.
welcome back to the 40th Street Group. I'm Alan Ripa with Bill Bob Fishman. Yeah, that's it.
We got a thing with Bills and Eds and whatever on the show, don't we?
We're on KFNX 1100 AM, and we're in the studio here with Richard Holland, Bill Mann, and also Renee Gero. And we're going to get back with Bill, and I had some questions for him as far as what age did you actually start writing and what inspired you to start writing?
Versus, like for me, I
played the piano. Why did you choose writing versus playing an instrument or something?
Well, I was trying to draw a tree in elementary school art class, and the teacher informed me that was the wrong way to draw a tree. So I had to resort to writing as the only avocation left.
So that's it. It's either drawing a tree or writing.
So I was right. You do now write on dead trees.
That's where
that came from.
Yes, but as a previous guest and Richard trying to discourage me from, I need to get away from paper and into the digital world. But yes. In the meantime, Paula Goes to the Pound.
Which is your current book, right?
It is. It's a beautiful, hardback, wonderfully illustrated book.
And you told us on the last show that this came from a true incident. And briefly, it was you had a neighbor who, and you go ahead and fill us in on that.
A neighbor who had a beautiful Irish setter. The dog was lured from the deck from her porch by the dog catcher, and the dog wound up at the pound. She didn't have the money to get the dog out, so her friend, a veteran named Motorcycle Mike, helped her break the dog out. As a second thought, they decided to break all the dogs out. They did wind up having to go to court, assume responsibility for what they did. This is all about teaching young people values, issues.
Is this in your book, basically?
Yes, it is.
So it's all in the book.
And so they go through the justice system, and they all get to serve community time with a judge who understands the situation. And
so there's a good result.
A happy ending.
Just like your book.
Yes, it is.
Your book, Paula Goes to the Pound, I'm holding it right here in my hands. It's a beautiful hardcover book.
It's the colors. It's so beautiful, and the artwork.
The writing
is
phenomenal. That's Bill's job.
Yeah.
And again, the dialogue and the writing is really fun.
And notice how the wording does rhyme, right?
Well, it's very. Like
well,
say, it's,
I was advised by school teachers and librarians in writing this to create a poetic style because it lent itself more to reading out loud, which is
and you combined your skills with Alexandra Colombo's illustration skills to make a beautiful hardcover book. This is great. So before we lose track of it, how do people get in touch with you to buy this book?
They can buy the book on Amazon. They can also reach me at author Bill Mann, M-A-N-N, all one word, author Bill Mann at gmail.com.
And then one thing you brought up before we went to commercial in the last segment, that you've done, you were doing other things, you've done other things, and you mentioned screenplays. Where are you at with screenplays?
Well, I'm writing one now that is the reason I hope to kidnap in a friendly way Richard for some consulting with his vast experience.
Have you done screenplays before?
I have.
And so have they gone anywhere?
One was optioned. It was a murder mystery involving the legacy of Marilyn Monroe.
Oh, wow.
But
did it get produced?
No, it didn't. It expired. But I'm rewriting it to be more contemporary with the current millennial generation.
This is fabulous. So you never know until you ask, you know? You never know until you ask.
Excellent.
So, Richard, since you're the person he wants to kidnap, and since you've had this vast brand building,
you're way too generous. But
I'm ahead. Not that generous. But tell so okay. So you get somebody like, and again, I don't know if this is. I guess this is sort of part of what you're doing currently, then, right? You help people to brand. You help people to get word out. So like in the case of a Bill Mann, what would be a typical thing that you might do in something like that?
Well, I'll be first to admit that I have minimal experience on the movie side of the studios in the L.A. area, Paramount, Columbia, TriStar. 20th century, all to have television and movie sections of their studios, and my work was always on the television side. But with those would be the connections to go a friend of a friend, a person from a person, to be able to connect you to the people that would consider and look at and read. But the number one thing is you need an agent, because they will not read an unrepresented script. Because if somewhere later on someone ever has a movie or a script that has a similar character or something, they don't want you to be able to claim plagiarism.
Well, this goes to my world as a writer, also a self-published writer. What is your best advice on how a person like me, who has published 3 books, can get to an agent, which these days is almost as difficult as getting to the publisher?
You will live or die by the quality of your work. And I do know a gentleman who started out as a self-published author, and by his third book, it was a series, and by his third, he had enough traction and enough notoriety that the publishers came to him. And now he now has a publisher, and he has a movie option on book number 2 as he's working on book number 4. And here's a piece of it. This goes to kids, for instance, who have bands. Is that in the old days you would go to a record label, and now they want to see kids who have a million views on their YouTube channel before they will even look at him. Because if the kids or an artist can create a product that gets traction in the marketplace, then the people who can make money off of it, the record labels or the book publishers or the movie studios, will then find the cream that's rising to the top, and they'll go after that. So if you do good work that starts to get traction in and of itself, now you as a single lone writer out there, you have the world at your fingertips through the internet, specifically through social media.
So if he gets a lot of buys on Amazon, for example,
yes,
is that okay?
For sure.
So Richard, let me ask you a quick question then. And this relates to Oliver, I guess, in a way. So some of the advice you're giving to Bill at the moment, some of the direction in a way, it also applies to, well, first of all, you mentioned connections. This whole radio show and also our Young Reporters radio show is all about the connectivity and how you might not be the expert in something, but you might know the expert in something.
Right.
And
so a friend of a friend.
Of the friend, and connecting to this, whatever, connect the dots.
Right.
And asking the right questions. And so this is part of the skill set I teach the kids that do the Young Reporters. And so you brought up something on one of our breaks about a St. Vincent de Paul thing that you were wondering about. So why don't you go to that?
Well, this relates to your passion in helping kids become self-sufficient.
Okay.
It relates to Rainey's passion through St. Vincent de Paul to help people to become self-sufficient. And also in a cursory way, it relates to Bill Mann and your character. And it has to do with because of our justice system and our penal system, that when someone makes a mistake, and primarily most felons have their offense in their late teens or early 20s, and by their late 20s, if someone is not offended, they're probably not going to offend. But because of the way their system is set up now, when someone becomes a felon, they can serve their debt to society, but that stamp of being a felon follows them for the rest of their life, that impacts their employability and where they can live, which then puts organizations like St. Vincent de Paul behind the eight ball of trying to help people become self-sufficient when they have literally both hands tied behind their back in terms of opportunity.
So what do you see as a St. Vincent de Paul related to that?
I think it's bigger. I think it is sociological, that from a sociological and political standpoint, it's really easy to say lock them up and throw away the key. The problem is that at some point they're going to get released, and then they come back
into
society.
Again, we've got about 30 seconds left in this segment. So, Renee, what does St. Vincent de Paul do with something like what Richard is describing?
It's funny that you mentioned this, because I'm working on a reentry program right now to expand what we're currently doing, because we will help those that are coming out of prison to get IDs, give them clothing, and then potentially pass them on to other resources. However,
by the way, we are going to go to commercial break. One of the other issues I know is housing. All these issues tie in. We are the 40th Street Group. We'll get to some of that in our next segment. We're flying through the show again. Bob Fishman along with Alan Ripa. And we've got Richard and Bill and Renee in our studio with us. We'll see you right after commercial break.
And welcome. welcome back to our last segment at KFNX 1100 AM. We are the 40th Street Group here co-hosting with Bob Fishman, and we have Richard Holland, Bill Mann, and Renee Gero. And we're talking about St. Vincent de Paul, and again, on your re-entry program that you're just developing right now. Can you elaborate a little more on that?
Yes, basically St. Vincent de Paul nationwide is working to expand the reentry program. So Arizona is now putting a lot of focus on it.
And you're talking about reentry once you've been in the prison system?
Right.
Okay.
Basically what happens is 50% of those that are in prison right now tend to be nonviolent offenders. And they are in there because they made a mistake when they were a teenager, or they had some minor drugs they were carrying in their car, something to that effect. And they have now been in the system. And once they are about to leave the system, they think their troubles are over. But unfortunately, that is not the case.
And that's something that we were discussing before, that you were working on a program where it might take that box off of the form that shows that they are a felon, right? Because that's a big hindrance of that follows them, that they can't get housing. And
correct. It's called Ban the Box.
Now, a move to make it easier for people who have been convicted of a crime to find employment after being released from prison. Several states and municipalities are preventing employers from asking about criminal convictions up front. The so-called Ban the Box movement would eliminate a checkbox on initial job applications. Brandis Friedman from our affiliate WTTW in Chicago has this report.
How do I know I can trust you?
It is a question any employer might ask the students in this room. Each of them has a felony conviction and has served time in prison, and each of them wants to prove to a future employer that he or she can be trusted. 26-year-old Carl Lynch is one of the students receiving job readiness training from the Safer Foundation, a nonprofit that helps released prisoners transition back into society.
The economy is always changing, and you know, jobs are always getting tougher, and I feel like it's just preparing me to be ready to go to reentry into the workforce.
Lynch was released from Illinois State Prison in early July after serving 2 years for breaking into a car with someone inside. He says a new job will help make him the father he once was to his two children.
I want to feel like the provider I was before I left. I know I never can get the time back, but it's important just for me to be there and let them know that, you know, dad's back.
He's hoping to get a job in hospitality or customer service, but the job search has been difficult, and Lynch thinks it's because of the tiny box on most job applications that asks candidates whether they've ever been convicted of a crime.
It makes you a little uncomfortable. You get that anxiety when you get to that box. It's like, wow, how are they going to judge me, you know, knowing that I committed this crime? How are they going to feel about this?
That has kept a lot of people out of the interview. With this question removed, that will really help you.
Illinois is the latest in a series of states and municipalities to pass a law prohibiting employers from asking applicants if they've been convicted of a felony on initial job applications. Phil Schreiber is a labor and employment attorney in Chicago.
Essentially, it delays when a prospective employer can inquire about a candidate's criminal history until the employer has notified the employee that the employee will be granted an initial interview.
While each law is slightly different, the goal for each is to get job applicants with convictions past the initial screening.
For example, Hawaii says you have to have a conditional offer of employment. Most of these laws have various exceptions that do vary somewhat from state to state as well.
The Illinois law, which takes effect January 1, 2015, applies only to private employers with 15 or more employees. It provides exemptions in situations where state or federal law prohibits hiring applicants with certain convictions, where the new hire would require a fidelity bond that insures employees who work with money, or where the new applicant would need to be licensed under the Emergency Medical Services Systems Act. Advocates say a bill like this has been a long time in the making.
Employment is the most direct link to reduce recidivism. When people are returning from prison, the first thing that they want to do is get a job to show their worthiness, to show their viability, first of all, to themselves and also to their families. Employment discrimination routinely denies that opportunity.
Safer Foundation's Director of Policy and Advocacy, Anthony Lowry, says as prison populations have boomed, governments are looking for ways to cut the expense of incarceration. And communities are looking to turn former inmates into productive citizens.
Is the biggest challenge of their lives. The criminal record is the new civil rights issue of our time. People are routinely denied opportunities for employment, no matter how minor the record is and no matter how old the record is.
The Illinois Department of Corrections releases about 30,000 inmates a year, and of them, half return to Chicago. Of those 15,000, experts say about 80% come to one of seven neighborhoods, like this one, Austin, unfortunately known for its culture of poverty and violence. Ban the Box advocates say when entire communities face a glut of people who can't get jobs, the cycle of poverty just keeps spinning.
I see it every day. I see people recommit and committed crimes that they've done in the past and think something different is going to happen, but it's not. That's why I don't want to go down that route again. I want to try to find work.
Under existing federal and state laws, employers aren't allowed to use a conviction as a pre-screening tool, but advocates say it's not working. Todd Belcore is the lead attorney of the Community Justice Unit at the Shriver National Center on Poverty Law.
Pre-screening is a constant. It's being done in nearly every state. And so that's why the movement actually precipitated, because people were frustrated. We were asking people who commit crimes and do all the time to get the education necessary, to get extra training, and do all these things to get their lives back on track. And when they do all those things, there's no job opportunities available for them because they're being denied outright.
But because of those laws, attorney Jeffrey Risch, who chairs the Illinois Chamber of Commerce Employment Law Council, argues ban the box measures aren't necessary.
Before ban the box, there was Title VII. Before ban the box, there was the Illinois Human Rights Act. There are a variety of federal laws that protect candidates from having employers use criminal convictions or arrest records as filters. Those exist. They still exist.
He says employers already following those existing laws won't have a problem obeying yet another one. And employers will still be allowed to learn an applicant's criminal history, just not up front.
How recent? What's the nature of the underlying offense? What facts can we gather? And what exactly, precisely, is this person going to do for the employer? All that has to be taken into consideration.
And that's exactly what advocates for people like Carl Lynch are hoping.
It motivates me to see a person go out there and get a job.
I'm going to feel like I got a good chance every day, because if I'm going to sit back and be sad and blue, that's not going to get me anywhere.
In Illinois alone, it could make a difference for more than 3 million people who have a criminal background.
A number of states are working on it, and we in Arizona are starting to work on it also. That's the box that's on the bottom of the job application or the housing application that basically puts that person in jeopardy of even being talked to, because that box has already been checked.
So what, because there are going to be a lot of people listening who will object on the basis of if they're violent criminals. Banning the box only for nonviolent? What would that apply to?
Basically nonviolent felons that have been in prison and then are coming out. They have done a minor, they've been incarcerated for a minor offense. And basically, once they get out, they're let out at 2 a.m. on a street in the desert and basically are given nothing to get to where they're supposed to go. If their family is even around, who knows? And they attempt to move back in the apartment with their family, and potentially the whole family can become homeless because of the way the system is now. And
Builder might be a children's book in this for you at some point.
I'm writing it as we go.
You know, when you think about somebody who is the writing from a children's framework, the person who's let out, but nobody wants them. That'd be I guess you are thinking about already.
This
huh?
will be Oliver Twist Part 2.
Okay, and so Richard, from the standpoint of, because you were mentioning again off air that you know you know people who are sort of in the midst of some of this kind of.
Well, yes. I through the magic of Facebook and social media, I learned that a high school classmate of mine from 35 years ago was a homeless, disabled veteran living on the streets of Phoenix. And through Facebook connections, I was able to find him and use my resources, my time, to help get him housing and get him reengaged back into the workforce. And it was a complete shock to me that because he was a felon, because he had made a mistake after he had been discharged from the military, disabled, that he was precluded. The majority of places we went that he could afford to live just absolutely would not even accept his application. And the point that I make is that someone can make a mistake, pay their debt to society that they're sentenced by the court to pay. And once they pay that, they continue to pay for the rest of their lives because they have that mark as a felon, regardless of however well they have rehabilitated themselves or become employable. And yet then we're surprised when they reoffend and they re-enter the penal system because they had to do something to try to get something to eat or a place to live.
I mean, so, Renee, on that basis, do you see any possibility, or has there even been conversation in government circles for people getting out of prison to have a classification that will follow them instead of just the bad marks that society brands them with, where people know they're nonviolent?
From a standpoint, we are working on that across the nation. It is something that we truly value because that is part of the main reason people become homeless. They are not given a house to live in. They are not given the chance to get a job and basically are out there stranded and not knowing where to go. So basically, from our standpoint, because we know this, we feel impelled that we need to do something about it. That person has done their time in prison. They've done their parole, and now they're still being punished for the rest of their lives, and that's not right.
Renee, at this point, from a St. Vincent de Paul standpoint, what you're doing, what do you need most at this point? Let's get some contact information for you. What's your contact information, and what do you need most at this point, you directly?
From a standpoint, anyone out there that is in prison ministry, please, we'd love to hear from you. We're trying to set up a plan to take this the next step further. We're trying to mentor within the prison so that before someone, whether man or woman, before they get out of prison, we basically can connect with them, get them lined up so when they are out of that door, basically they have a potential job to go to and a house to go to.
One of my goals tied in with that, this has been for quite a number of years now, since I teach kids communications, one of my goals has been to get in the prison system because people, again, are dealing with brutalized self-esteem, obviously, at this point. And so this is all about giving voice to people. And so giving kids a voice, giving juvenile offenders a voice, and probably giving battered women. So we might have a conversation in terms of some future possibilities of giving a real voice to people who don't have much power.
Absolutely.
So your contact information is what?
I can be reached at St. Vincent de Paul. My email is R, and the last name, no space, Gero, G as in George, E-R-O, at svdpaz.org, R-Gero, that's R-G-E-R-O, at svdpaz.org.
And so you're mostly looking to get that prison ministry contact going. Okay, good. Richard, let's get your contact information as well, and I've got another quick question for you after that.
RichardAHolland.com.
And they'd be mostly getting in touch with you for what?
Anything from strategic planning to video production to website design to speech writing to presentation construction or strategy.
I got it. Richard, we're getting real close to the end of our show here, so maybe we have 30 seconds for each guest. But real quick, and we've already gotten Bill's contact information earlier in the show, so we covered that. You seem to have a lot of information on a lot of different things. What drives – you're a very passionate person. What drives that? Is
curiosity.
That a lifelong
curiosity.
Curiosity? Okay.
Ask questions. I want to know everything about everything.
And so you've learned a lot of things just by asking questions.
It's fun.
It is fun, isn't it? Bill, obviously, you get inspired to write.
I do. I could and am writing full-time, probably 12 hours a day, nonstop. And a person like Richard is of particular interest to me because my question would be, how does a person who's writing and creating have time for creating social media?
You know, what's funny about that is that
we need people at the technical level to help us.
The issue is general, believe me, in terms of you might be good at some things, but you're not good at everything. And so it needs to be team stuff. I'm big on team, as Alan knows. This has been a great show again, Alan. Once again, you brought great people in the studio. We'd never have enough time. But Alan Ripa is co-host and co-producer for the show, or actually producer for the show. I'm Bob Fishman. We've had Richard Holland, Bill Mann, and Renee Gero in the studio with us.
And I just wanted to say, too,
we're running out of time. Go ahead, real quick.
Thank you for the opportunity to let me co-host and bring in the guests.
Happy New Year to you and to all of our guests.
Happy New Year
to everyone.
Yes.
Thank you all for listening. Thank you, Robert Baumbach, for
being here.
We'll see you in 2 weeks with the 40 Street Group. Next week, the Young Reporters.